taking place here at the Trade and Development Symposium. And it's really the first opportunity to have a public discussion on some of the outcomes of the E15 effort before we go to the public launch in Davos in a couple of weeks' time. And today's session is focused on services and global value chains. We have here an excellent and numerous cast to talk to you. So let me try and introduce them all very, very briefly. We have second on my left, Sherry Stevenson, senior fellow at ICTSD. We have down at the far end, we have Pascal Canes, managing director of the European Services Forum. Between them, we have Pranav Kumar, head of international trade policy at the Confederation of Indian Industry. In the middle, on my right, we have Stephen Karingi, who is director of the Regional Integration and Trade Division at UNECA. Immediately to my right, we have Paulina Nazal, who is the director for multilateral economic affairs at the General Directorate on International Economic Relations in Chile. At my far right, we have François Rousseau, who is a partner at Bain & Company, based out of Johannesburg. And immediately to my left, we have Patrick Lowe, who goes by the formal title of the fellow at the Asia Global Institute at the University of Hong Kong. So thank you all very much for turning up and sharing your thoughts with us today. And I think the main question we're going to try and address is what reforms to services and global value chains would result in better growth and development outcomes. But you're at liberty to diverge from that specific question as you see fit. Now, I've asked each of the panelists to try and come up with a 60-second message just to kick us off. So really just a sentence or two on what they think are their key thoughts. And this is news to Patrick, so I'll let him go last. And in fairness, I think, to all the panelists, I should probably have a go at that as well. So my suggestion would be to say that I think the success of global value chains is really quite largely dependent, or even regional value chains, on services, in that they are able to tie together these otherwise somewhat disparate and arm's length trading relationships. However, the facilitation efforts that we've seen over the past couple of years have been really quite focused on goods trade. And so we have a large opportunity before us to improve facilitation efforts on trade and investment in services. So that's my helpful thought. But let me dive in and ask each of the panelists to share really just one sentence or so their highlights before they go in a bit more depth. So maybe Sherry, would you like to start?
Thanks very much. Is this on? Yes. So my 60-second soundbite on value chains is that these offer opportunities for developing countries to engage in international trade in ways that are more suited to their size and their capital base. And however, we don't know all of the developmental implications yet from value chains, and these may be somewhat controversial, and they need to be further studied and understood.
Fantastic. Thanks, Sherry. Move along to the left, Pranav.
Yeah, thank you. For me, if I represent Indian industry, so of course I've been asked to make a representation and comments from the perspective of emerging economies. And global value chain, of course, extremely important, particularly when we see from the angle of, from the lens of manufacturing sector revival, where there is a great emphasis on, in India particularly, how we can revive our manufacturing so that our growth level further rises. And manufacturing revival cannot happen without the global value chain, because now in today's world, manufacturing just cannot happen at one place. You have to spread your production network, and to build the final product, you have to have a very efficient services network, and that is where the role of services in the manufacturing process is very important and the global value chain.
Fantastic, thank you. Pascal?
Thank you. I'm coming from the European Services Forum, so representing the services industry. So I'm going to talk a bit about, there is also a global value chain for services and services only. But then, of course, coming back to what the others are going to say about the services part of the global manufacturing value chain, what I'm calling the global value added chain, which is all the services around the products. And to conclude, maybe some words about the link with the trade policy, how trade policy can improve the global value added chain. Thank you.
Thank you. Patrick, you ready?
Yeah. Thank you. So the simple message that I intend to convey is the one that Bill Clinton's chief political strategist employed in the first election campaign, which was to put a big notice on the wall saying, it's jobs stupid, or it's the economy stupid. I wanted to say it's services, but I'm not going to call you stupid. And so I'm going to focus on some of the fundamentals that we need to take into account when we have all these discussions about of services. I'd like to say something brief as well about digital services.
Thank you. Only that.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation and give me the opportunity to share the Chilean experience in global value chain, in particular in the services area. In my few seconds, I just would like to highlight the importance of a strong public policy regarding to be inserted in global value chain and to services. What is the role that us as a government has to do to propel growth through this important new tendency in globalization, segmentation of production, and to focus in the second stage of developing that countries like us, small economies, quite open to the rest of the world and quite dependent on natural resources, has to do to help exporter and importer of services, in particular in this area, to take this good opportunity in global value chain.
Oh, thank you very much, Sean. Good afternoon, everyone. My 60 seconds. Well, the world has changed. The world is changing. Development challenges for countries like those in Africa remain the same and remain relevant. Now, the question is whether the policy tools and the analytical tools that we are using to understand and to deal with these challenges, whether they remain relevant. And I think those are some of the points I'll be drawing out as a discussant of the two papers.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm gonna take a very practical approach to the topic, explaining how this global value chain have emerged over time and how people like us, which pretty much represent the dark side of the force, have helped doing that. And then I'll go through some of the practical challenges that we are observing on a day-to-day basis, dealing with those global value chain integrations.
Great, well, thank you all. And I should mention that the World Economic Forum, we've worked with Bain for many years on some global value chain trade facilitation work, so very grateful for that. What we're going to do now is we're going to ask each of the panelists to take 7 or 8 minutes to try and share their main thoughts on the topic. And to kick us off, I think I'm going to ask the two panelists on my left to try and condense a little bit what were some of the main considerations within the E15 discussions over the past couple of years, and what are some of the main policy outcomes which have emerged from that. So maybe, Patrick, you can start on the services.
So what I'd like to do with my time is just to run over what it is that we know about services and why we should be concerned about them, and then I'll say a little bit about new services. So for a long time, and still today, services have been neglected analytically, and they've been neglected by policymakers, and yet they are the largest part of value in the global economy, and the richer a country gets, the more intense is its reliance on services as sources of income, growth, jobs, and everything else. And there's a very strong correlation in the relationship in the services GDP ratio to the level of income of a country. So if we're becoming more and more dependent on services, and we didn't really understand until quite recently the significance of services in international trade because of essentially a statistical problem. We were measuring trade in gross terms, not like GDP, which we measure in value-added terms, and all the services, not all of them, the ones that came out on the balance of payments, because they were counted, but they used to come to less than a quarter of the total. But once you start to use a value-added approach to looking at trade, you find that the share of services jumps dramatically up to, the estimates are between 45 and 50 percent, but actually it's more than that because there are technical reasons why you're still not counting properly, but we can go into those if anyone's interested. So that's the reality. So how do we explain the neglect? Well, you go back to, this goes back a long way. This goes back to Adam Smith, this disregard for services. And it's largely based on the reason for this is largely the classical value of theory. It's classical theory of value, sorry. And that basically is that accumulation is value. And you can't accumulate services, or at least you couldn't then. These days you can accumulate more of them. You can store some more of them than you used to be able to, but still there are quite a few you can't. And in those days, we probably couldn't store any at all, really. Very, very few. So that was why they were considered to be valueless. And then later in the 60s, when economists started to see what was happening to GDP, the composition of GDP, and they saw that in the United States it was getting bigger and bigger services, we got into another problem because there was this conviction that services were incapable of contributing to productivity growth. And we got something called the Baumol disease. Baumol, Fuchs, people like this were working on this, and they figured, and they were looking basically at government services and entertainment services, and they figured that services were a dead duck as far as productivity growth was concerned. And yet, because of wage pull, the sectors that were productive and were setting wages in these unproductive sectors were also going up, and that this was going to eventually impoverish the country. Services did have a very promising role as a source of productivity growth. So that all began to change. But the troubles for services didn't end there, because there's a very difficult information and data-related issues which we haven't overcome and which we haven't invested nearly enough in trying to address. Intangibility is the only thing, in my opinion, that distinguishes services from goods. We spend an awful lot of time pretending that services and goods are completely different worlds when they're actually not, and that's going to be a big message of Sherry's on global value chains. But because they're invisible, and because they're often customized, and no two people get identical treatment from the dentist, so there's this customization, also makes it hard to identify them and to identify the value. In addition, increasingly, especially as consumers begin to become much more influential in decisions by producers, thanks to modern technology largely, the idea that you can measure or that you can contract or that you can price all the services that you're selling, that are creating value for you, has become a very difficult idea to actually believe in. There are lots of services which we simply don't value. And what are they? And economists might try to find, people like Richard Neufarmer might try and find price equivalents for them and tell us what the price equivalents are. But I would hazard a guess that was a guess. So these are some of the realities and challenges that we have to deal with. Nomenclature. In international trade, they haven't been able to agree on a standardized nomenclature. And just getting the data. If you look at the data on services. And on top of that, now we still have a big problem, which is policy. Making services available at decent prices. And this feeds into competitiveness in all sorts of unfortunate ways. So that I don't go on too long, let me switch to... So that's basically the idea behind all this. And one of the things that we've been working on in the last couple of years is trying to get some sense of how important services are, how they enter the production, how much of them are outsourced. And what we find is that there's a vast array of services that enter production, huge numbers of services. And very often, you don't even think of them. And when we talk to businesses, sometimes they say, we're busy, go away. But other times they say, my goodness, we didn't actually think of it like that. That's really interesting. There must be some things that we're missing. So it's very real, this problem, I think, of misinformation, a lack of information, and a lack of comprehension of what the true nature of services and their role in the economy. It's changing, it's getting a lot better. But that was kind of what was driving our work on E15. There is a set of services, on the other hand, new services, which are basically digital, the ones I have in mind, that escape some of this, for the most part. But there are a lot of people who worry that they won't continue to escape it. There's an agreement in the WTO which says that you can't tax e-commerce. That agreement has been contested by some interests who really think it's a great source of revenue, if you can actually catch them. But the thing about, and then there's a whole question of data localization. So as a policy issue, this is hot. And there are real interests across the road, if they ever could agree on anything, to try and do something on this as well, to start looking at the digital economy as part of the services that should be negotiated. So what's interesting about this for a country like Kenya? Kenya is getting a pretty significant chunk of its income these days from the digital economy. What's great about the internet and e-commerce is that entry costs are really low. You can get a platform, and you can be selling worldwide with a staff of two people. And it's a very interesting new economy, which we're only just beginning to understand, but the people who are in this economy are really growing their businesses. So I think that's another interesting part, and I just mention it because I think that one of the things that, for example, the Kenya government would love to see more work done on getting international cooperation in e-commerce because they know where their interests lie. I'll stop with that.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you very much. I'll take up the issue of global value chains and some of the considerations of the E15 group in this regard. It was a challenging task because global value chains are very multidimensional. They have many different facets, and it took a while to grapple with all of these and understand their complexities, and I think we're still just in the process of doing that. So I'm going to make my remarks around four main points, and the first one being that global value chains are an important part of the current structure and reality of world trade. They've arisen because of the phenomenon of growing trade in intermediates, which itself is a product of the dramatic lowering of transportation costs and the cost of ICT, telecommunications. Now B2B intermediate trade accounts for over two-thirds of the goods and nearly three-fourths of the services traded worldwide. And much of these are offshore services that are used in global production networks. And services, I should emphasize, are today considered tradable. They've gone from being considered non-tradable to being tradable, and their tradable nature is underscored by the role that they play in global value chains as the links or the glue between the different segments in the phases of the production networks. Second point, GVCs offer many opportunities for developing countries to engage in international trade in ways that are more conducive to their size and their capital base, so that they can provide tasks as opposed to finished products into these production networks. For many developing countries, GVC participation could be seen as a new pathway to economic development by generating enhanced foreign direct investment, technology transfer, and knowledge spillovers from global firms to local suppliers. This is thought to stimulate innovation, higher economic growth, and greater integration to global markets. There's been a lot of talk about GVCs, both pro and con. We know this. Yesterday, I heard in a panel Minister Ploumen of the Netherlands saying that global value chains offer wonderful opportunities to trade, create jobs, and add wealth for countries' populations. But GVCs are not being addressed in the WTO framework, so we should do everything possible to actually discuss these. Later, these sentiments were echoed by Minister of Trade Andrew Robb of Australia. But we've also heard many other countries and ministers come out with equal conviction against global value chains, expressing large amounts of skepticism, particularly about their inclusion in WTO discussions. So what do we know factually? We know factually that developing countries that participate more extensively in global value chains have been shown by the UNCTAD to have a 2% faster growth on average, a GDP per capita growth, than those developing countries that do not participate extensively in global value chains. So this is an empirical study. But we also know that the current pattern of global value chains is not inclusive, that these are concentrated primarily in three regions of the world, North America, Europe, and East Asia. And that part of the problematic of value chains is that they are de facto carving up the world into areas of differing market spaces and differing degrees of investor attraction. Third point, trade policy plays a role in GVCs, but it's only a small part of the story. So part of what we were tasked to do is to find the link in the E15 group was to find the link between global value chains and trade policy and trade. And we found it. But we found that this link is really only a smaller part of a very much larger picture. And while trade policy is key to GVC participation in the sense of creating open trade policy, understanding that tariffs and restrictions on services act as taxes to firms who wish to participate in GVCs, and understanding that the market in a GVC context is the entire world. So we have to know that when the world is the market, tariffs and services restrictions do not protect, but they harm domestic suppliers who wish to integrate into world markets. But we also discovered that trade agreements, PTAs, may influence the direction which GVCs operate by influencing investment patterns and by linking crucially up smaller markets to larger, more dynamic markets. And we've seen that in terms of the regional operation of global value chains. And currently, we have mega regionals that are being negotiated with the TPP recently concluded that may have additional implications in terms of trade diversion, as these will create spaces where GVCs can operate by linking markets into larger groupings under a common set of rules. So these value chains, we've also discovered, are increasingly being determined by investment flows, which is what is highly influenced by trade agreements. But the other bigger part of the story, perhaps, in addition to trade policy, is the domestic policies that are needed for countries to develop the capacity to participate in GVCs. And this was really beyond the scope of our group, since we were to link this to international trade, but nonetheless, we have to recognize that it was really the factors at home in terms of capacity building that were crucial in this effort. That was the educational systems to develop human capital, especially for services. It was good quality institutions that had a rule of law for contract enforcement and adequate infrastructure, particularly in transport and telecommunication. These all center on a domestic capacity building agenda. And unfortunately, to date, this has not had a GVC focus or been linked well with the aid for trade efforts, particularly in the services area. Fourth and last point, not all of the developmental implications of participating in global value chains are well understood or have been studied. And this is important. So we could not come to definitive conclusions in this regard. The jury is still out on many key issues, such as what kind of value can be drawn for developing countries from participating in global value chains, and what is their ability to move up within these value chains. Many major doubts center around the following: the ability of global value chain participation to actually increase the transfer of skills and technology from lead firms to local suppliers, to the actual value that developing countries draw from GVC participation, which might be shown to be dependent upon the sector and industry in question, maybe even upon the lead firm in question. Three, the amount and type of job creation offered by global value chains. Are these the type of employment one wants, and does entry into GVC necessarily lead to higher skill and better paid jobs? And lastly, the footloose nature of much of GVC investment, which is predominantly led by multinational corporations and perhaps can be displaced easily when market conditions change. So these doubts are still out. The jury is out on this. Much more study is needed. And that's part of the options that the value chain group has suggesting. But in summary, I would say that our deliberations after 2 years came to the conclusion that global value chains are like a complex animal. The whole is more than the sum of its parts, but all of the parts have to be present for it to function well. So GVCs really require a holistic approach to policymaking and a coordinated set of mutually reinforcing domestic policies, together with appropriate trade policies on one hand and appropriate domestic policies on the other, and supporting institutions. Targeting participation in GVCs requires what the World Economic Forum and the World Bank Group have labeled a whole of supply chain approach, meaning that governments must deal with more complex issues and with a large set of policy interdependencies. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sherry. Okay, so there we have a bit of the policy background to these two issues of services and global value chains. Maybe, Pranav, we can turn to you now and maybe touch a little bit on some of the political dynamics. And again, obviously, as you mentioned earlier, from an emerging economy perspective would be interesting. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. Two great observations by Patrick and Sherry, and I agree with most of the views expressed by both of them. In fact, the global value chain is a reality that we all accept, and this is being accepted by a large number of developing countries also. If you look at the current, recent World Trade statistics from released from the World Trade Organization, 49 to 50% of trade is happening within the global value chain. 70% of world trade is happening in intermediate products. So all these are indicative of the fact that this strong global value chain or supply chain is working. Second most important part, when you said that political economy aspect of this global value chain, and since I am very glad that Sherry has raised the issue of that the current model, which is led by OECD and some Latin American countries, that's not very inclusive. And that is where the concern of majority of developing countries, including India. In India also, this is being debated with the government within industry, but it is much debated but least understood subject in India. Still, we are trying to see how we can be a lead player or significant major player in the global value chain. And the whole exercise of India's, if you look at the manufacturing revival through Making India campaign, most of you have heard, because our Prime Minister is going all over the world trying to publicize that very campaign which is on when he came into power last year. There are 25 sectors which have been selected. It is not only manufacturing. There are a host of other services sector also which are part of the focus in Making India. And simultaneously with Making India, he has also launched the Digital India, Skill India, Startup India. So all accompanying and peripheral policies, he is giving equal importance to those policies, because without those policies, you just cannot help revive manufacturing. Now, the third issue is because when we talk about integrating the developing economies and poor economies into the global value chain, you have to undertake a whole host of reforms. And that is where the political economy comes. Because in a country like India particularly, is a fragmented politics, 1.25 billion population, it's very hard to develop a consensus on any particular issues. So there is an advantage and disadvantage of democracy. There is a consensus view which takes time, and that is what we are grappling with India also. There is a political intent across political parties. They want the reform process to go, but of course there is a politics involved, and that is where the problem is. The pace of reforms differs. Now, the development dimension of global value chain, that is very important. And if we talk about import facilitation or trade facilitation, which we talk about, particularly when we talk about global value chain, integrating into global value chain by developing countries, small and medium enterprise developing economies, you have to improve your trade facilitation infrastructure, you have to improve your transport infrastructure, you have to create a digital infrastructure, you have to invest a huge amount of resources on skilling of people particularly. So all these are huge tasks for any small economy or any poor economy to undertake, and that is required, and that has to be looked quite sympathetically, because there is a cost to reforms. If we try to advocate in one go that all these countries in the name of global value chain take a massive economic reforms, then this might be counterproductive. So that is very important. If you look at the global value chain and the focus from the developing economies particularly, in fact, efforts were being made particularly if the current global value chain is being modeled on the OECD, it's OECD-led global value chain, but particularly free trade agreements and South-South free trade agreements which have been negotiated, agreed, and implemented in the recent last one decade or so. And that has the component of goods, service, and investment. And that speaks a lot that because these countries are trying to see how the investment link, how the trade in services and trade in goods, all three can be integrated together. But somehow we have seen that, particularly from a country like India, though we have negotiated free trade agreements with many developing economies, but somehow that has not translated into the desired result of benefit. There could be several reasons, but we have to examine that. Though there is an, so there is an effort on the part of developing economies to build global value chain, particularly the South-South global value chain, and that is where we need to concentrate and try to prepare developing countries. If they are successful in building the South-South global value chain, that will set a stage for getting integrated into larger value chain. Thank you.
Great, thanks. Maybe turn to you now, Pascal, to talk a little bit about the business opportunity from liberalizing services to trade GVCs. You know, are your members excited about this? Not holding their breath?
Yeah, certainly very much excited. They are doing it on a daily basis, probably without knowing it. I wanted to maybe tell you what could be a global value chain for the services sectors, because it is essentially said that it is part of the goods. But that is not true only. If you take banking and insurance, for instance, you have a lot of those companies who are having now outsource their some services like the back office services, the human resources services, the invoice services, the data center services. All of those services are not part of the bank itself. And it is in the world. A big global bank, for instance, would have typically 4 or 5 data center. So that's part of the global services way of doing. For the banking, it's really a global value chain also. The logistic companies, transport, airline, express services, shipping, they are very much into the global value chain also. They are using hubs, they are using data center, they are using warehouses, they are using port services, harbor services. All of those services, depending on the efficiency, will actually be the one which is going to be picked up by these companies to have their hubs functioning well. So depending on the welcoming of the legislation of these countries, that would be certainly a look that they will have. Tourism is also another part where you have a lot of a global value chain. And now we hear about it, Airbnb, or you hear about booking.com, or you hear about Uber. All of those companies are actually providing global value chain. And you have, without these services working properly, maybe some hotels would not be as full as they are now. So without these services, that's going to be more difficult for them. So I wanted just to say, pick up some examples of saying that global value chain is also for the services sectors. But now let me come back of what I talked about the global value added chain. The Swedish National Board of Trade issued a survey 1 or 2 years ago on this, a word which is a bit complicated to say, but it is summarizing the whole stuff. It's about the servicification of the economy. It is saying that manufacturing, actually it's not only about manufacturing, agro-industry, food industry, raw materials, all the economy will be better, will be more competitive if they use the services within their own company to be more competitive, either embedded or embodied services. And a manufacturing company doing Caterpillar machines, which is consider itself as a 100% manufacturing goods producing company, is actually using more than 40 services which are listed into the GATS negotiations every day. Such a company will use legal services, accounting services, medical services, printing services, telecom services, financial services, insurance services every day. If they are not competitive, these services, that manufacturing company will not sell its good as easier or as competitive as it would be if these services would not be efficient. Then these companies also, without knowing most of the time, are actually selling services and could be considered as services companies. And such a Caterpillar machine producer company will use computer services every day, will use research and development, which is a service, will use rental and leasing services, will, of course, provide maintenance and repair. And nowadays, we talk about the environmental goods agreement. We're trying to see how these machines are working. Nowadays, you more and more have so-called machine-to-machine communications. And in each of the windmills turbines, in each of the engine of the plane that you took to come here, there are sensors. And in these sensors, they are sending some data to the headquarters to say, oh, that part of that engine will need to be changed in 1 month's time. And the logistic machine chain is going to be put into place so that the place is going to arrive at the right place at the right moment. Without data flow, this will not work. Without services around these things, this will not work. So there are many of those services which are very important for the whole these goods producers, and that is what I'm calling the global value added chain. As we know, the world trade is essentially counted into balance of payment terms, where 20% of the world trade is services and 80% is goods. But that is not reflecting the reality at all. If you put the services which are embedded into these goods, actually the share of the services part is going to be about 50 to 55% of the world trade in the developed countries, and 40 to 45% in the developing countries. So services is actually much more important in terms of trade than it is actually counted in balance of payment, and would require that the trade policy negotiators will actually give more importance to that. And I fully agree with Patrick earlier on when he said services has been completely neglected into the trade negotiations. And we have been put after agriculture, after NAMA, and eventually we have time, we're going to talk about services. Well, this is a major mistake of the trade policy. And that is also maybe explaining why we're into such a dilemma in moving into WTO and other places. We in Europe consider that it is not possible to have a trade agreement without serious services chapter and services commitment. Because this is our economy. Our economy is 80% of GDP in services. And it is reflected also in the figures of the investment part. More than 60% of the world trade investment is into services. And that is not sufficiently reflected either into the trade negotiations. How can we now try to reconciliate? We have to tell the manufacturers, we have to tell the farmers, that they need to understand the services dimension of their own work. And how to make sure that the services, the agriculture negotiators and the NAMA negotiators are going to come and see the services negotiate. They need to understand it. Mode one commitment. It is discussed as a cross-border services. But it's not only for services. It's for all people using digital economy. When we talk about mode four, movement of natural person, this is negotiated under the services chapter. But it is not only for services people. It's actually to move the people who are going to maintain this wind turbine at a point in time. So all of those things which are negotiated under the services part are actually not only about services. And finally, the mode three, which is a commercial presence abroad, they are also in our new trade agreement. It is not only about services part. Of course, the GATS is only about services. But into the bilaterals and mega regionals, we are talking about mode three for not only services, but also for the raw material, for the farming, for the fishing, for the manufacturing, incidental to services, incidental to manufacturing. So all of that is making me make a plea to please take services seriously. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, I think it could be useful for you, first of all, trying to put it in figure what is Chile and what has been our history behind our participation in global value chain during the last decade. You know, as a small country, we have had a remarkable economic performance during the last decade. Since 1990 to 2014, our economy grew at a rate, an average of 5%. So what explained that at the first place was a vigorous and ambitious trade agenda and an investment liberalization, trade agreements, and integration. We are part right now of course, WTO, OECD member, APEC member, a WIPO member, so we participate in many international areas. This is why we are an open economy, and as you may know, Chile has specialized in recent decades in exporting mainly commodities, and most notably in the mining sector. You know, we have been known around the world as the main copper export in the world. But in addition to that, we export agriculture, forestry, and all products related with that. So given that emphasis, it is quite natural for us that our participation in global value chain has been focused mainly on supplying those commodities to the global production chain. However, at the same time, this highly reliance on natural resources expose our economy to external shock. If you sum the economic crisis that we have been experiencing as a world since 2008, 2009, the world economic growth has been declining, and our economy also suffered from that phenomenon. During the last year, in 2014, our economy passed to grow from, on average, 5%, as I mentioned before, to now almost 2%. So what will happen, we had to leave a little bit back our investment and innovation investment. Beside, we have a really low rate of investment in research and development, for example, compared to another partner at the OECD economies. And you have to add the shock that suffered the commodity prices, the copper, which rise at $4 more or less, is less than $2 right now, that our export depend, 50% of our export basket depend on copper. So when the price goes half of the price was a huge shock for us. So what happened with that? Well, that's triggered our mind as a government. So we have to look something in the future. We have this challenge, what we are going to do. So we were rethinking Chile's economic growth. And here enter into the picture and in the global value chain. Of course, we have been participating in global value chain, but we haven't that in mind at present, what as a country has to do to participate in a better way. And to get a more sustainable growth, because we will see that our forecast for the next 5 years is going to remain the same at a very low rate for us, if the country doesn't assume that challenges that we have to face in order to implement some public policy to increase our growth. So services. Services, of course, for us, the main services export and the main countries that we export services as, of course, at the region, Latin American region. We have a language barrier, of course, of that. So in that scenario, Latin American region for us is the main destiny of our export. So we saw there a great opportunity to broaden and expand our participation in those chains by exporting a more diverse basket of services, including information technology, professional services, and design of service. But we have a lot of ideas regarding that services and the role of services in our economy. If we count the total of export services in Chile, that represents only 14% of our export basket. If you add value added of that world, all the services that include in, for example, manufacturing, as our colleague mentioned before, it's this share rise to 30%. But even though it's double the participation, we know that we can participate a little bit more. So we took seriously the challenge of a global value chain and the role of services, and we request to the OECD a diagnostic evaluation situation of our country, which we thought as the main tool that we have to know where is the country right now, in what area we will have some potential to increase our export in general and the role of services there. So that study was focused in three main areas: trade, foreign investment, and innovation, which we saw as the main deficit that we have in our economy. I don't know if we are going to have some time to share with you the results and the outcome, the main outcome.
Quick highlights.
I'm going to give you a quick guideline of what are the results of the case of Chile. First of all, that's something that we knew before, that the diversification of our export was so low. We have low product diversification, as I mentioned before, because we are so dependent on copper and mining product, forestry and agriculture. We have low market diversification. 50% of our export go to Asia, and 30% of non-export are going to Latin American country. So regional value chains are an opportunity to further integrate in Latin America. We have low diversification in time, at what we call the survival rate. So many companies that export once, it's quite difficult that remain on the time. They just stay there around 2 or 3 years at the market. So we have low diversification in export value, and the size of company is also very low. It's we, of all total exporting companies, just 1.8% are SMEs, which, you know, it's one of the main important labor participation in our economy. So what are next are the challenges that the OECD mentioned for in our particular case? First, national challenges that we have to face in terms of regulation. We have still some logistic and transportation sector. We have some deficit there to improve. We have to attract more foreign investment. We just recently created an adjacent investment promotion agency to try to focus this and attract more investment in innovation and technology to our country. We have to invest more in innovation, as I mentioned before. The rate of innovation investment in our country is 0.39% compared to more than 10 or 20% that in many OECD countries. We have a deficit in education. We are in the middle of a huge reform in our education system in Chile, because we saw there as a deficit. We need more skilled and prepared people to face these challenges to participate in global market. And diversification. How? Well, we have a network of free trade agreement and me, as a government of the Foreign Affairs Ministry, we have a huge role there. So we have a network of 25 free trade agreements with 64 economies, which represent more than 90% of our total export to the world, and 60% of global population, and 85% of world GDP. So we saw there a really interesting focus that we were to... We were to be prepared to take more advantage of those free trade agreements in that particular area. So improve competitiveness in key services sector, logistics, energy, water, and transport. And in addition, we have to keep working on our agenda on productivity, innovation, and growth to tackle these new challenges. Thank you.
Thank you, Paulina. Maybe we should just mix things up a tiny little bit and go to private sector now, and then come back to you, Stephen. Maybe Francois, can you tell us a little bit about Bain's experience on helping countries and firms with some of these challenges, and what needs to be done to help people to integrate to global value chains, and well, your experience as a service provider, internationally?
Well, thank you, Sean. As we heard, this is a very, very complex topic. So I had the opportunity to talk to Sean before I decided to join you guys, and my question was very straightforward: what should I talk about? And you know, and he was very relaxed and said, well, you need to talk about 5 minutes. So here we go, my 5 minutes on this extremely complex topic. And thank you, Sean, for the recommendation. Well, you know, actually, this is pretty much, we're pretty much at the point of arrival of 50 to 60 years of business strategic thinking. Because if you think about what a lot of large corporations have been doing over those past 60 years, it's actually doing two things. One is what we used to call in the consultant jargon deconstructing the value chain, which is pretty much around thinking of the business not as one integrated business, but as a set of independent activities. And so that decision was pretty much, should I be in that activity or should I outsource it to someone else that's more capable, that has bigger scale, that has the technology, etc. So that led to a lot of fragmentation in the value chain. And by the way, that also led in the growth of services, because some of the services mechanically emerge from that deconstruction. If you think of a manufacturing plant, you know, these guys used to have a gardener and a driver and everything, and then all of a sudden they outsourced that to a service company. So the service actually grew on the back of that outsourcing mechanism. The other thing that they've done is really deciding on what to inshore and what to offshore. And that was based on many considerations, a mix of costs, but also a mix of, let's not kid ourselves, on tax decisions, and then finally on markets that were attractive, which required specific manufacturing and services locally. So What emerged over time is actually a very, very disintegrated network of activities and services that are managed under the same roof by companies such as Unilever, Nissan, General Motors, etc. So actually the lives of those executives have become much more complex over time because they used to run their own business integrated and now they have to deal with literally hundreds of suppliers, multiple manufacturing locations, thousands of customers and everything. And so the first, you know, the first challenge actually is if you think of that, of the complexity of those networks, is actually to make them work daily. I mean, not once a year, but every day you have to ship products from one point to the next. You have to serve your customers with a mix of integrated operations, outsourced operations, etc. So really in our experience, the most difficult part is about making those global value chain work every day. You know, just anecdotes. I mean, we as Bain, we have a graphics. The people who, you know, who build our slides, they're located in Poland now. So how do you interact with these guys on a daily basis? I mean, there's obviously language issues. You know, there's cultural things. They work 9 to 5, and consultants typically don't work 9 to 5. So there are actually a lot of very practical matters. Now, in terms of challenges, what we've observed is you know, there's four actually in four different buckets and a fifth one that I'm going to conclude on. The first one has to do with, you know, market access. Really, there are all kinds of quotas, import taxes. Sometimes you need to localize part of the work, which is not economical, like in the oil and gas industry. There's been a lot of localization requirements from local countries, but sometimes it's not economical to do that locally, so it's a hurdle. There's obviously all kinds of issues with border administration. You know, the time it takes to clear a container in Durban is ridiculous as compared to what it is in Antwerp. And the sort of the bureaucracy in certain countries wastes a lot of time. So when you want to manage tight supply chains, you know, it's really a problem. Infrastructure is a massive issue as well, you know, transportation, but also IT networks, etc. I'm always amazed. I had the opportunity to join the Johannesburg office about 3 months ago. The wireless connections are nowhere close to what they are in Europe. So that's something that practically generates all kinds of frustration. And then finally, what we've observed is that oftentimes the business environment actually fluctuates depending on, you know, different governments. So once a new government comes, then they change the law, the tax system, etc. So a lot of corporations are wrestling with the idea of setting up massive capital in that area if, you know, the tax system can change after 3 years. And coming from France, you know, it's something that not only happens in the emerging countries, but also in some of the very mature countries. So there's a lot of practical issues that people are wrestling with. The final one, and I think to the point that Sean was making about what have we experienced as Bain, but a lot of, you know, other companies have experienced in terms of how difficult it is to connect those value chains, is actually the talent pool. There's not enough talented people on the planet. And in certain geographies, we're all fighting for the same talents. Like in South Africa, people coming from the best business schools, I mean, they have offers from the investment banks, from the consultant, from the top firms, etc. So it's not only about getting these guys to work for you and managing this hugely complex network of loosely connected businesses, but it's also training them to your own practices, making sure that you deliver the same product consistently across the geographies. And finally, it's actually retaining them, because once you've trained them, they've become very capable Unilever, Procter & Gamble, GMC executives, then they have all kinds of opportunities. So I think the key challenge is around actually accessing those key talents, training them. And there's no way the global value chain would work without those very talented individuals. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Stephen. Sorry, Francois. Confusing, Stephen.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I apologize.
And if anybody wants a job, obviously just talk to Francois. He's clearly got plenty. Stephen, can I hand over to you to talk a little bit, try and integrate some of these perspectives on and how you've seen things work in the countries you operate in?
Okay, thank you very much, Sean. Let me try, first of all, to stick to the script that I was given, but hopefully by the end of the day, I'll be able to show how the two are integrated. What I was asked to do when I was asked to join this panel is actually to be a discussant of the two papers, one on the GVCs and the one on the services. It so happens that the two others, who at least who brought together all the think pieces and all the conversations that led to the policy options that are being presented under the global value chains and the one under services are both here, and actually they took the floor as we started the session. That is the paper, the GVC story by Sherry and the services story by Patrick. So let me tell you what are the policy options that the papers are presenting. This is still under discussion, and probably if I present these policy options, you will be able to see how it integrates to all that was said this afternoon. Under the global value chains paper, which Sean said that will be presented at the WEF sometime next year, some of the policy options include developing and refining the knowledge tools so that we can understand better the global value chains, establishing an independent global value chain development platform, establishing specific supply chain councils, convening a regular supply chain summit, the establishment of a horizontal work program in the WTO, the establishment of new international cooperative arrangements, and adopting a supply chain informed approach into negotiations. Now, all these options have been put in the publication, you know, ranging from the short term to the medium term. Now, why am I saying this? Because as you can see, those options actually try to address some of the questions that have actually come up on the issue of the global value chains. Now, in the services paper, the options cut across five areas: the digital economy, the services and SMEs, the role of soft law, regulatory cooperation, and then greater compatibility between the rules, or rather the international rules, that govern goods and services, because of the whole story that really the way we have been dealing with these two issues separately, maybe we need to rethink when it comes to configuring trade agreements and also inserting the international trade law. So I decided to start with those options because this allows me to make 5 points of what I saw in the discussion. Now, let me say that these two sets of policy options have actually come out of a lot of discussions, including a discussion like the one we are having here. So I can say that the main question that is posed by the two papers and that led to these two policy options comes back to the point that I made through my 60 seconds, and that is whether policy making today is in tandem with the changing landscape of the global economy. And so the question is whether the tools that we are using, or at least the tools that our negotiators are using, or those who support them, are appropriate to this evolved or evolving global changes in the production and the trading networks. Now, so this is a clear question that is raised under the discussions of the global value chains, and I think the same question has come up from this intervention. Now, so the important point that I thought in reviewing the two papers that is worth making is that the domestic policies that are aimed at facilitating the integration of the countries, including African countries, into the global value chains, go beyond trade policy instruments. And so, do we believe, as we sit here, that the current global trade governance can do justice to the new reality that we are witnessing? Now, as for the second paper that relates to services, what the paper argues is that negotiators, the regulators, and for that matter, the policymakers, seem to be living in a world that no longer exists, or one that they misunderstand. The paper does give good examples of why services today are not as we understood them before, and I think we have had the same points here. The digitization of the economy, the unbound possibilities of an SME that is located in Nairobi, going global and joining a global value chain, all of them make sense as to why there is this important need to rethink our understanding of services trade. And I think the paper makes a very compelling argument to that effect. Now, the paper does, again, strongly make the case that the four modes of services as we think them or as we treat services today seem to be a bit constraining. And this is because the servicification of the economy is still not a mainstream policy issue, yet it should be one of the mainstream policy issues in our thinking. So what then did I see as an emerging theme that cuts across the two issues of the GVCs and the services? One of the themes that was emerging is that production and trade is not just local, but that now it's also happening at farms in a way that differs from our classic understanding of things, or at least our classic understanding of economics. And I think the technological advancement, the reduction in costs, have made the unit of policy analysis to be at the farm level. So we can no longer ignore drilling down to the farm level of analysis if we are to understand better the services and the GVC issues. In other words, as a theme, both papers are saying that we might need to rethink the way trade is analyzed and also the way it is governed. So I ask the question then, and I think it's good to ask this question, at least in Africa, because one of the things that I thought in all this discourse was that actually Africa was assumed away. And the reason why it appeared to be assumed away was actually because the database and the tools of analysis that are currently being used by the OECD, which I'm very familiar with, they do not actually have database for African countries. I think Fran is here, it's only Tunisia and South Africa that have trading value added that can at least help the African negotiators or their support or those who support them to really understand this discourse of the global value chains. So I would say that I found that the two papers are a good contribution to the body of knowledge, at least in the policy-making perspective. Although I would like to say, I think it is just a start. So by saying this, I'm saying it might be a bit too early to implement some of the policy options that were actually presented by the two papers. We can come back to what are those options that I think it is too early to do. The other key point I would like to make is that, which is an emerging theme, is that the development dimension of the global value chains participation and the implications of the sophistication is still not fully understood. And really, I would like us to think what then do we do to understand this better? And I think, even though the idea of establishing a horizontal work program at the WTO is actually a noble one, this needs to happen when there is full understanding of the issues, some of which have been articulated by the panel. So what are the implications of these two papers, of these two issues? The first one is that we know very little. And I think from Francois, it is clear maybe a lot of us know very little about GVCs and where we operate and the role of services. And the pace of change is actually complicating the situation. And I think that is what one of the others said. Another implication of the two papers is the need for deeper policy dialogue on global value chains. And I think the Chile example was actually pointing out to the policy dialogue that is led by the OECD on the GVCs. So where do we go from here? I think we need to fill the gaps, and we need to dialogue a bit more so that we can be able, we need to fill the gaps, construct the data, make sure that that data is inclusive, the platforms for the discussions on the GVCs, make them open and inclusive, and then when it comes now to putting the agenda of these policy options at the global level, I think we'll be in a better position to ensure that the developing countries, at least they are not left behind. Because I can tell you, these policy options, whether we like it or not, they are going to influence the future discussions of the trade and investment agenda in the global rules making. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephen. I think that was a very helpful summing up. We have quite a full room here, so I think I'd like to get some questions, comments from the audience. Maybe we can get a microphone circulating. You can also phone in questions to Patrick. He's making calls.
Thank you.
Maybe we can start with the other.
Many thanks for your presentation. I'm Wei from Bambanabadis. I think participating in global value chains have benefits for developing countries, in particular those at the bottom of the value chain, and also pose a lot of challenges to them. The benefit include, as you mentioned, technology transfer, job creation, and some others. And the challenges including, for example, from the environmental perspective, there is carbon leakage concerns, and also there is maybe over-exploitation of the natural resource in developing countries. And from the social dimension, there may be a fair distribution of the profit. For example, one iPad product or one Apple product, maybe the profit 80% or 90% will go to the multinational companies in developed countries, but for the manufacturers and for the manufacturing companies, they only have like 10% profit probably. And how would we address these concerns? Will we have some fair pricing practice? For example, to introduce some standards to, at least minimum standards at a global level to regulate the fair pricing of each component of the product. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we'll collect two or three. Anna?
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Anna Escobedo, ArcelorMittal. First of all, thank you for the presentation. I have maybe two questions. As part of a longer supply chain of manufacturing, in the practical purposes, the challenges we see linked to regulation is the basic implementation of regulation. Moving one product to the other, we see, well, okay, custom tariffs is one point, but we see lack of homologation of standards between countries. We see, as Mr. Kerner said, a lack of service infrastructure support. So more and more we are, let's say, asking our governments to help us solve this homologation to bilateral discussions. They do it to a lot of FTA discussions. I think TTIP, this is a key element on homologation of regulations, which is one of the main elements for supply chain. What is your view? I'm interested also in Mr. Kumar's view, because India has a very important, part on the supply chain. Why is the Indian view regarding, should this be solved at a bilateral way, just thinking FTAs, or do we need to put, maybe for the other panelists, a more broader schemes at WTO level? Half of the problems are trade issues, and half the other half are service issues. We don't have structure for current transferring, we don't have financial services infrastructure, etc. Thank you.
Maybe one or two more.
Thank you for the presentation, Lambert Buerta from South Africa. I've got a question, maybe it's a blunt question. For a developing country, your entry into global value chains. Would it be easier to, especially capital-intensive sectors, would you rather go into providing a service supportive of manufacturing or extraction, or would you rather go into supportive services into those manufacturing? Why I'm asking the question is I was attending a oil and gas conference for Eastern Africa, local content requirements, etc. So the question arose in my mind, would it be easier for those countries rather to build a services platform to service the oil companies instead of trying to build a manufacturing so-called basis in order to replicate or to partner with oil and gas companies? So as a point of entry into those global value chains, wouldn't it be easier to have auditing firms providing that sort of supportive services, transport services, which are maybe easier attainable because it doesn't require a lot of as much capital as a capital-intensive manufacturing plant? What is your view on that? Thank you.
All right, thank you. Let's have a crack at those. Maybe I'll sort of try and throw them out, but anybody else jump in. So maybe our first question was to do with environmental issues, distributional questions, and the like. I don't know, Paulina, do you feel something you can comment on from Chilean perspective, or somebody else want to take that one on?
I was about to take the second question.
Well, do that one as well, that's right, and then we'll...
Yeah, but anyway, maybe something related to your question too. And the second part of your question, as you mentioned, and you are very right, there's a lack of implementation of regulation that could be useful to be better inserted in global value change. There's a lack of services, investment, support, infrastructure, everything else. What is the role of maybe free trade agreement, or what is better, what is not better between bilateral, plurilateral, and multilateral trade agreement? Actually, in our particular case as a developing economy, it's all of them. We have been following the three of those approaches, and it has been, in our case, very useful. In my personal view, nothing compares to multilateral trading system. I think it's slower, but it has a huge impact, of course, around the world. But till the last, 5 years, we have been very involved and we have been very useful, and more useful that bilateral advances is a plurilateral approach. The recent Trans-Pacific Partnership is one of actually a very good example of us, what can we do as an economy to face and put that global value chain. And actually, the Trans-Pacific Partnership put that discussion in the middle because there's a lot of regulation that we are dealing in that agreement, as, for example, regulatory coherence, which is quite important when you are facing an export process. The Pacific Alliance, and just let me be a little bit local about the region, which is another integration initiative between Colombia, Peru, Chile, and Mexico, which followed the same aspect. I mean, we took that problem that we have not only in our region, because we have been experiencing this regulatory problem in many other countries. So we took that and we tried to face to simplify many regulation, even accumulation of origin, which is quite important when you export product, and in our case services, liberalization of services and update of what we negotiated many years ago, the GATT, the trading services agreement under the WTO. We update all that regulation in order to exactly face the problem that we have been experiencing in the past.
Thank you. Good. So I think, Anna, your question was also you wanted it directed to Pranava. I'm guessing maybe Francois may have an opinion on it, on how do you actually get the regulatory homologation.
Yeah, I think you have raised the issue of, first, of course, the implementation of basic reforms and regulation. That's a challenge. And when you look at the history of economic reform in the recent past in many developing countries particularly. And that has been realized through trade agreements. WTO, of course, played a major role, and of course, some of the trade agreements. And second important is the unilateral reforms. But I don't know, I'm not sure how many countries have gone ahead and went ahead on unilateral reforms. But of course, now because of the political aspect of trade negotiations, that country like India and many countries are now resisting that, for instance, in the current round of negotiations also the new issues are being propagated by some countries. So that is one aspect of it. And if you look at a second important, more practical region, that is the cost of reforms and capacity to undertake those reforms. For instance, if the Competition Commission, as a result of discussing WTO, many countries in the last 10 years have gone ahead and set up, adopted new competition law, set up a competition commission. But in order to undertake those policies forward, you need trained competition experts. But in many countries of the world, particularly poor countries, developing countries, we don't have competition experts. So capacity aspect is very important. Reforms is one aspect you can go ahead, you can undertake. But in order to practice those reforms, implement those reforms successfully to achieve a desired result, you need to have a trained manpower also. So that aspect is very critical.
Final point on that one. Otherwise, should we go on to the third question on essentially development strategy? Anybody want to?
Doesn't work after all. Just one thing on standards and on. What you call homologation, which I take to mean harmonization. There is another way of doing this, which is a shortcut to it, which is mutual recognition. And if you can get that, you're doing a lot better. The problem with mutual recognition is it tends to exclude poorer countries sometimes. So I think there's a real challenge there. But I think the risk of doing this regionally and not multilaterally is that you'll get fragmentation, you'll get different systems, and they'll be very hard to integrate later.
And also to add to Anna's question, which is actually quite at the heart of the way trade flows work today, I think the main objectives of trade agreements today, one of the main ones, is to reduce regulatory heterogeneity. And this being said, it's also one of the most ambitious and difficult things to do. Reducing this obviously allowed trade to flow better and GVCs to operate more effectively. The first best option in reducing regulatory heterogeneity is obviously at the multilateral level, but we know that the WTO hasn't really been negotiating services seriously for the last 8 years, so our first best option at present hasn't been open. The second best option is clearly to do this amongst as large a group of countries as possible, so that your effective market for your investors and your exporters is as large a market as you can have in terms of trying to either harmonize regulations, which is, as Patrick said, highly unrealistic in most cases, or at least make sure that your recognition requirements and equivalency procedures operate better and more smoothly. And the more you do this amongst a larger group of countries, the more effective your trade can be.
Great, thanks. We are running towards the end of the session, so I think maybe what we'll try and do is ask each panelist to take, 90 seconds, 2 minutes to... Yeah, go for 2 minutes.
Well, it's actually a very interesting question, honestly. And I'm not sure the answer to the question is either or. Because if you think of the examples that you mentioned, the oil industry is very specific in a sense that you are actually transforming a natural resource. And so it's very legitimate from a government to try to add value to the resource instead of just sending it overseas. Now, conversely, so I think in the example that you're using, I would try to probably follow both routes, meaning add certain manufacturing capabilities on top, like drilling, etc., and then also follow the service route. Conversely, in industries where you don't own the resource, for all kinds of reasons, and I'm happy to follow the discussion later, I would rather go the service route because manufacturing itself has become, and it's pretty sad to say, it's become a global commodity. So following the manufacturing route, and puts you pretty much in competition with the rest of the world and is very likely to generate very
Thank you. Well, let's be honest. The new issues discussions is actually about the challenges that the GVCs and the sophistication of the economy is posing. Now, the reality is, you know, policymakers are going to be left behind by the businesses because the private sector is not going to wait because innovation continues. So, it's a high time that we started working hard to understand these issues. Now, the second thing is, yes, it's true, developing countries are part and parcel of the global value chains, but precisely for the same, for the questions that are being raised here, we need to do more as developing countries because there is so much of forward integration, which is low value, and what we need in these economies is actually backward integration, which allows you to reap more value from the global value chains and even develop your services sector.
Great, thank you, Stephen. François, did you have a final comment you wanted to make?
Well, maybe just one, maybe a bit of a provocative observation. There is a risk that actually some of the emerging, and one of the actually the largest emerged market will gradually inshore some of those activities. Because of technological reasons, because now, for example, if you think of 3D printing that allows you to make all kinds of things at a very cheap price, close to the end market, and also because the US have, over the past 20 years, outsourced a lot of stuff, and now they're starting to realize that managing those hugely complex supply chain is a problem for them. And so as they become more competitive in manufacturing because of the oil price and because of some technologies, they might actually inshore. And so I think there's a call for action here that if you collectively do not solve some of these issues, it's very likely that what we've observed about over the past 50 years might actually turn around and become more like a regional footprint and less of a global footprint.
Well, just a few bullets on my last minute. I think, well, to enhance the value of our services export and our participation in global value chain, I think we definitely need a strong public policy, not just for international trade, but many barriers you find domestically. So, for example, the one you mentioned, and the data that we need to have an accurate diagnostic of the particular situation of the country is quite important. In our case, we had a lot of problems to get that data. And if you don't have that, you cannot make implement the correct public policy. The second, of course, to take full advantage of foreign trade and investment trade policy, and what we are doing right now here at this beautiful Nairobi at the WTO conference is trying to deal with that. And the third of them, the third direction, is enhance again R&D investment. We have seen a lot of course, for developing economy, it's more important to have this issue in mind to take full advantage of the services extra. And I just said that's the last one. You have to face many risks that you have. Diversify your economy, diversify your export basket. So for that, services show us a good opportunity to the economic growth and development. Thank you.
Thank you. Pascal, final thoughts on digital or anything else?
Well, yes, of course, the new agreements are focused on digital product, digital world, and probably already the TPP is already too old because the world is going too fast for trade negotiators. So we're going to focus now on TTIP to see whether we can update them. This is the way the private sector is thinking. And when I'm sitting here, And I very much like the Stephen analysis about we need a diagnosis, we need more data. I'm calling this lack of data on services for the last 20 years, but it is not improving. It is not stopping the world moving either. Now, I don't share the view that we need to wait to make a proper assessment and then for the developing country to better understand the situation to take decision. I think we should stop this policy of preconditions. The world is moving on. If the politicians don't want to understand it, it's going to be too late. It is increasing the divide. The only need for developing countries to catch up is to engage and take action, not to wait and make good assessment. We have thousands of good pages of very good studies on everything. We know what the situation is. It can be reflected in one sentence: take action, move on. And I'm sorry to hear that in 200 meters from here, nothing is going to happen. And the business people I know here in Nairobi, we are get maybe 80 foreign people from business sectors. My colleagues don't come anymore to these events because they're not interested, because we know nothing is going to happen. So let me say again, we need to move on because business is moving on and therefore the trade policy needs to move on also. Thank you.
Okay, so let me just, last final observation, that's very two remarks, one by Patrick and one by Pascal, on the how the services agreement and services negotiations has progressed. And as Patrick has mentioned, that policies towards services were not very friendly in the trade agreements, particularly regulation. And that is where we need to address. In fact, in WTO also, as Pascal mentioned, that GATS has always been given, I won't say stepmotherly, but not given as equal preference what we have given to NAMA and agriculture. So that is where we need to, we have a challenge, how we can put GATS on the priority list and give more thrust to the services sector agreement. Second important point is the mode four, the movement of professionals, and that is increasingly being recognized as an important component in the global value chain, and mode four movement of people has to play a major role in the global value chain. And that is getting increasingly sensitive in the current scenario of the political scenario and the security also. And that is we need to address. So these two points I'd like.
Sherry, over to you. Yes. Feel free to touch on movement of people or not.
Thanks, Narishan. I won't go there right now. We have 30 seconds. So I just want to conclude with respect to three or four bullet points on value chains. One is we need, in the case of value chains, to take a holistic view of policies. It's really extremely important. They're complex. We need to look at them participating from how best to participate, bring in appropriate trade policies, bring in particularly appropriate domestic policies to support more open and more competitive trade policies. Second, focus on efficient services in order to help participation in global value chains. Efficient services are absolutely key, and they are the one way that developing countries can actually access value chains more easily, perhaps even than certain manufacturers. Three, capacity building is a big part of the picture. And we need to focus more of our capacity building efforts on services, and particularly services regulatory reforms. Four, we need to look at the developmental implications of global value chain participation in more detail. And hopefully this development platform that has been suggested by the GVC E15 group, together with some of the other informational activities, proactive forums such as the supply chain councils, will help shed more light exactly on how these value chains operate, and particularly what are their implications for developing countries in engaging in one sector versus another, how to move up, and what kind of gains they benefit from them. Thanks.
Thanks, Sharon. Likewise, Patrick, feel free to touch on soft law or not.
No, I was going to touch on this question about whether it's better to try and encourage services or manufacturing in a value chain world. I think it's a bit of a false alternative in the sense that it'll depend entirely on what the options are from a competitiveness angle and from the resource situation. But what I do think is important, and I may disagree with Francois about this, I'm not sure, is that I don't believe in leapfrogging. I think it's very difficult to imagine real development taking place without a manufacturing sector being part of that story. There are many reasons for that, but I think we should probably leave that for another time. But I think the evidence is pretty overwhelming, notwithstanding technology, that, and notwithstanding the things that services can do, and do, a lot of the services demand is derived anyway in manufacturing. So I think it's going to be very hard to just forget about manufacturing.
Yeah, well, thank you all to the participants for having been so disciplined, getting so many of you in such a short time. Thanks to ICTSD for hosting us. Thanks to you for joining. And again, please join me in thanking the panelists.